after very two powerful discourses, nothing much is left for me to say. But I must tell you why I am here. When I see young India, I get a feeling that you as engineering students are the engineers of the future of India. You as law students are the lawmakers of the future of India. You as students of MBA are the future managers of the Indian polity. Let me be honest and frankly admit, confess, that my generation has failed in India as far as protection of human rights is concerned. I look upon you as the harbingers and the torch bearers of a new revolution in this country for establishment of human rights. When I was of your age, I was an activist. We all dreamt of a revolution. Years have gone by, I see you silent. But I still remember those days with nostalgia. And there is one revolutionary song which used to inspire us all. You have had up till now a very theoretical discussion on human rights and human rights in practice. But there have been a lot of poets who have contributed towards spreading consciousness about the importance of human rights. With your permission, I will recite one poem which used to inspire my generation. It is addressed to you as young. Nau javano tere kando par jagat ka bhar hai, tere man par hi chal raha sansar. What a beautiful poem. Teri taakat ki kahani aaj darya ga raha hai, phool mein teri hi lali tu vasant bahar. It's a long poem, the last stanza. Jee rahe kuch log lekin murdon se battar hai. This is today's India. Jee rahe kuch log lekin murdon se battar hai. Zindagi mein kya bhala mila agar khaak bankar mar gaye. Wo nahi marte jahan mein jo kaam kuch kar gaye. इसीलिए तो ही शहीदों की क्षमा गुलजार है। नौजवान अब हु आर माय आइकॉन्स इन यंग डेज फर्स्ट सोक्रेटिस व्हाट आई हैव लर्न फ्रॉम सोक्रेटिस ए राइट टू रेज क्वेश्चंस एंड चैलेंज द अथॉरिटी. I want you to develop that habit. Raise questions concerning all matters that affect human life. As long as there is human life, we cannot separate human rights. They are an inseparable part of the same phenomenon. Who is my next icon? Galileo. He challenged the religious bigotry and said that it is the earth which moves around the sun and not vice versa. How many of you know to propound this scientific proposition based on scientific data, Galileo was trying. They are the real harbingers of revolution in human rights. Who is my third icon? Jesus Christ. He challenged the authority of people who were trying to dominate the society. And in contemporary times, my icon was Bertrand Russell, a perfect rationalist, a pacifist. During World War II, he held demonstrations against the war, and for that he was jailed. Can there be any greater icon than Russell? So my friends, we expect from you a new kind of leadership in all walks of life. Now let me leave you with a few questions which have troubled me always. And not that I have found a solution to it. The question is this: the man was born free everywhere, but he is in chains everywhere. And what are those chains? Ignorance, poverty, lack of good health, unemployment, victims of religious bigotry, narrow-mindedness. These are all chains. Now what is the connection between human rights and education? This is a fundamental connection. Our forefathers taught us, Sa Vidya Ya Vimuktaye. Don't think that I belong to a particular party because I said something in Sanskrit. I profess no political ideology, save and except that of nationalism. What is this? Mukti from what? It is liberation from ignorance. It is liberation from poverty. It's a liberation from social inequality. This is what is the vital connection between the education and human rights. Unless every child in this country gets education, every human being has a decent source of livelihood. Now it is in this context I want to pose my fundamental question to you. If you go back to say 1 million years, I am not sure as to exactly when the human civilization started. My question to you is this: whether human development of so-called civilization has resulted in denial of human rights for vast masses. First came the concept of property. So some have, some don't have. When we lived according to the nature, everybody had food, everybody had water, everybody had some kind of shelter, though in a primitive form. We live in a state of equality. But as the human civilization started developing, we created nations. We created walls of caste, creed, religion, language. And some acquired property, some became rulers, some became slaves, some started dominating, others became victims. Look at the history of any country and please find an answer whether human civilization has created a situation where there is denial of human rights. A very serious question. No historian, no philosopher, no political leader has thought about it. Why I got this idea? I read one book. This was on the life of Che Guevara. Again, let me tell you, I am not a Marxist in any sense of that. But I do believe that Marx was the first social scientist who tried to understand the working of human society on some scientific basis. Che Guevara, who was a part of the Cuban Revolution with Castro, one fine morning he was missing from Cuba. And everybody thought that in a power struggle probably he had been eliminated, as it used to happen in the communist countries. But years later it was found that Che Guevara was somewhere in some jungles of South Africa. And it is said that he wrote a letter to Castro, and that letter states something like this. He said that when we were leading the people's revolution, we were the people's power. We believed in the values of human freedom. But the moment we got and captured the state power, our power has shown a tendency to be anti-people. Mark, these are the words of Che Guevara. Maybe that this may be in tune with the classical Marxist doctrine of a state is an engine of oppression. Whether it is so or not is not the question. The question is this, whether the state power, whether of this party or that party, is anti-people or not. Does it have a tendency to become anti-people or not? We got freedom in 1947. I was just born. I still recall those days when I first heard the recorded voice of the then Prime Minister of India, Jawaharlal Nehru, on the midnight of 14th and 15th August 1947. He said, at the stroke of the midnight hour, when the world sleeps, India awakes to life and freedom. Have we really awakened after 70 years to life of freedom? Ask this question to yourself, ask this question to your own conscience, and ask this question to everybody who comes to ask for your vote. The concept of human rights that is being talked about is a very narrow concept. A right to protest? Yes, essential. A right to form organization? Yes, essential. A right to free debate, yes, essential. But is that enough? Unless every person in this country is free from bondage of poverty, ignorance, backwardness, inequality, this all talk about the human rights is hollow. Look at what Rabindranath Tagore said to his Gitanjali. In my view, before I quote Tagore from Gitanjali, the human rights come not from the generosity of the state. It is not because the parliament has enacted the Human Rights Act 1993 or that the Constitution of India has a chapter on fundamental rights. It's a natural right of every human being and which no state can deny. And it is the denial of this right which must be debated in this country. The kind of political and economic system that we have evolved in this country for 70 years has miserably failed to solve the basic problems related to human rights. What do we do? And look at our failure. My generation, we claim to be great intellectuals and we have solutions for every problem under the sun. But we have not been evolved, we have not been able to evolve any system which at least at an intellectual plane can deal with these problems. This is our massive challenge. How do we ensure that we drink clean water? There are knee-jerk reactions. How do you ensure that we breathe pollution-free air? All right, ban the crackers. Does it solve the problem? Do not allow the vehicles to run. Does that solve the problem? My dear engineering students, all these problems can be solved through technology. What research we have done in this country in the last 70 years? We are just borrowing and aping the technology of the West without considering whether it suits the native genius or not. This is your challenge as engineering students. Of law, it's a challenge to you to create a new legal structure which would facilitate the emancipation of the people who are in bondage. Filing a few cases in the Supreme Court and being an activist on the front page of Times of India or any newspaper doesn't solve the problem. It's only because I'm not able to do something, I try to satisfy my conscience that I have done something for the poor people. No, we have to create a new structure. When I discuss these problems, people feel that I am talking of a utopia. Or a Ram Rajya. Or a Jannat. Or a God's kingdom. Or a Marxist doctrine of there will be administration of things and there will be no government of men and the state will wither away. This is not, I am not talking of utopia. If human rights has to be a reality, we need technology. We need a new culture in our legal system. We need new leadership in every walk of life. Mere way, the nation is not in your hand. You are a passing generation. Please think seriously just getting B, you are not going to be a good citizen of India. You must ask yourself what you can do for the country. That does not mean that you don't take a job and 24 hours think of the country. Think of your baby also. Think of a good source of livelihood also. But with all this, keep somewhere in your mind that the nation needs you. Your involvement in the national life is of paramount importance. Think about it, what you can do. If your collective efforts, your brainstorming sessions can promote new ideas, it will lead to betterment of our brothers and sisters who are languishing in poverty. Now, before I end, let me quote Tagore, for which he got the Nobel Prize, the passage from Gitanjali. Where the mind is free, where the head is held high, where the mind is free and the head is held high, where knowledge is free, where the words come out from the depth of the truth. Where the world has not been broken into fragments by narrow domestic walls, where the clear stream of reason has not lost its way in the dreary desert sand of the earth. Where the tireless striving stretches its arm towards perfection, and where the mind is led forward by thee, if you believe in God, where the mind is led forward by thee into ever-winding thought and action, into that heaven of freedom, my Father, let my country go. For the atheist, that he can be your own conscience. Thank you very much. Very much.
The learned speakers on the back.